Welcome back to Matt's Movie Nights, where I recommend movies and we talk about them. Last time we had some movies starring Bruce Campbell and directed by Don Coscarelli. Not all three of them were either of those things. One of them was. You can see Don Coscarelli's name is barely fitting on the sign here. And the second L is an upside down F, because both of these people have two L's in their name. So to start us off, I finally finished the Evil Dead trilogy with Army of Darkness, not directed by Don Coscarelli, directed by Sam Raimi. It's pretty well known. I mean, this is the Evil Dead trilogy is what Sam Raimi is probably best known for. Maybe the Spider-Man movies. Maybe the Spider-Man movies, but I mean, how many people actually know who Sam Raimi is? Like, if you know who Sam Raimi is, it's because you watched the Evil Dead movies, not because you watched Spider-Man. So, Army of Darkness is the third and final movie in the Evil Dead series. Technically, the Evil Dead remake is canon to the original three, and also there's the TV show Ash versus the Evil Dead. Which I only watched, like, the first three episodes of. I should finish that series. It seemed like an interesting series. Never made it past the first couple episodes, though, because I'm very bad at watching TV. I've also not watched the Evil Dead remake, although I hear good things about it. I hear a lot of people say, like, it didn't get a fair shake because it came out during a period full of, like, horrendously shitty horror remakes, so that's kind of why I was avoiding it. I'm like, oh my god, all these fucking movies, all these fucking horror movies getting remade in like 2008 to like 2013. We just remade like every horror movie from the 80s. But from what I've heard, the Evil Dead remake is pretty good. So, you will not hear me badmouth it because I have not watched it. At the end of Evil Dead 2, Ash is, of course, teleported back in time to become the prophesied hero written about in the Necronomicon, and this movie picks up right where that leaves off, with Ash far in the distant past, in medieval times. He's been captured by this local kingdom who's at war with this other kingdom, and they think Ash is part of the opposing kingdom. Very quickly, though, he starts using his chainsaw and his shotgun, and it's very clear he is extremely powerful with those two things. And also, deadites start attacking, so he's gotta fight off those. He has to recover the Necronomicon in order to save the kingdom and so that the wizards can send him home. But he of course is being tormented by spirits the whole time, who don't want him to get a hold of the Necronomicon. And this leads to him splitting off into a second person, Evil Ash. And he kills Evil Ash and buries him. But then when he gets the Necronomicon, he doesn't say the right words when he picks up the Necronomicon, and it curses the whole land. And so all of the skeletons are rising from the dead, and Evil Ash, who's now, like, totally deformed skeleton man, is their leader. So Ash, like, builds this whole army of people to, like, defend the castle from the oncoming skeleton invasion. And protect the Necronomicon. That's important. He has to protect the Necronomicon so that he can go home. This is probably my least favorite of the Evil Dead trilogy, but it's still a fucking amazing movie. It's still, like, one of my absolute favorites because, I don't know, I just love the whole Evil Dead trilogy. This one's a lot sillier than the others. There's not quite as much horror to it. I would say there is very little that is overtly scary in this movie. Most of the horror elements are being played for comedy. Which is, you know, a step down from Evil Dead 2, which yeah, I said in my review of that movie, one of the things I love about Evil Dead 2 is that it combines horror and comedy so well, because, like, the horror scenes and are the comedy scenes. Like, there's something very funny about the horror of Evil Dead 2. This one, it's more just, like, a total comedy. And also, it's like a parody of action movies. It's much more action-y than the previous installments of Army of Darkness. And so you will occasionally see Ash thrown in with, like, crazy 80s action heroes. Now, Ash, of course, is obviously supposed to be, like, a parody of those types of, like, action heroes, because he's just, like, absurdly good at fucking everything. This movie is, like, so totally unrealistic in ways that the first two Evil Dead movies aren't really. The first two are cheesy, but all of the weird stuff comes from, like, supernatural elements. In this film, you've got stuff like Ash, like, leaping through the air and just, like, connecting with his chainsaw hand. That's, like, nope, that couldn't happen. And he, several times in the movie, he's using his gun and he'll just, like, shoot something behind him without even looking. And it's like, yeah, okay, haha. It's, like, it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun to watch, but it's like, yeah, this isn't realistic at all. It's just, it's a great movie. There's a reason everyone loves this one. I think there's people who've, like, seen Army of Darkness without having seen the other two Evil Dead movies. And to be fair, I watched Evil Dead 1, and then I watched Army of Darkness without watching Evil Dead 2. Evil Dead 2 was the last one I watched. Now, the reason for that is because my local library had a copy of Army of Darkness, and it did not have a copy of the first two Evil Dead movies. I think that's mostly just library policy. They won't put, like, because the first Evil Dead was NC-17 on release, and our library won't rent out NC-17 movies. They also have just a really piss-poor horror selection. They have, like, none of the Halloween movies, none of the Nightmare on Elm Street movies, none of the Friday the 13th movies. I'm like, do you guys have any horror at all? If they have horror, it's from, like, the last 10 years. And or it's, like, super old Universal monster movie stuff. They have none of, like, the classic 70s and 80s horror. That is my one complaint about my local library system. Otherwise, god damn, I love the library. God damn, I love their movie selection. You see all this? I wouldn't be doing, like, movie stuff right now if it wasn't for the library. I watched so many fucking movies through the library. Support your local library, folks. Anyways, this is, the Scream Factory Special Edition. It's got four different versions of the movie. I watched the theatrical cut because I'm not totally sure what the difference between these are. I Googled it, and it didn't seem like there was any extra violence in the director's cut or the international cut, which is, that's the reason I tend to watch extended cuts, is because the extended cuts tend to be a little more violent. But from what I've read, the director's cut cuts out a lot of, like, the cheesy one-liners Ash has, which is just, why would you do that? That's what makes this movie. They cut out the line, good, bad, I'm the guy with the gun, which is just one of the greatest lines in any action movie. Also, this is just me personally, I've always preferred the theatrical ending to the movie. I've seen the alternate ending, where he, in the alternate ending, he's given this, like, vial of stuff that's supposed to put him to sleep for long enough that he will wake up in his own time. But, in the original ending, he takes too much and sleeps to, like, the distant future. And I prefer the regular ending where he returns to his own time, goes back to working at S-Mart, but is constantly plagued by deadites and just has to kill them all the time. Which is the canon ending, because that sets up Ash versus Army Dark, or Ash versus the Evil Dead, the TV series. So that's the canon ending for this movie. Although, I would be interested in an Evil Dead movie set in the distant future, like 2100, 2200 Army Evil Dead movie. That'd be an interesting direction to go with the series. But I prefer the more action-y ending. The reason they did the wake up in the distant future one is because something bad always happens to Ash at the end. Something bad happens to Ash at the end of Evil Dead and Evil Dead 2. And so I think they just wanted to continue that running gag. And I don't know. I think it works better if he goes back to his own time but is now plagued by deadites. That's just a better ending. So, other than the alternate ending, which I don't think is in the international cut, I don't know what differences there are between the theatrical... I know some of the differences between the theatrical cut and the director's cut. I don't know about the international cut. I don't know what's going on in that one. There's also a television cut, but no way in hell am I going to watch that because... You know, the television version's gonna cut out all the good stuff. And by the good stuff, I mean the bloodshed. So, yeah, Army of Darkness. If you somehow have not seen Army of Darkness, please do. Although, I would recommend the other two Evil Dead movies first. After that, we had Bubba Ho-Tep, directed by Don Coscarelli and starring Bruce Campbell. Bubba Ho-Tep is the story of Elvis Presley, maybe. So, according to the movie, at some point, Elvis, the real Elvis, switched places with an Elvis impersonator. And the Elvis impersonator is the one who did a shitload of drugs and died. And now the real Elvis is in a nursing home in East Texas. Even though he wouldn't have been that old when this movie came out. He'd have been in like in his mid to late 60s. So I don't know that Elvis should be in a old folks home that young. Although it's... Part of his story is that he broke his hip and that's why he had to stop being an Elvis impersonator. The movie doesn't really reveal if he really is Elvis, or if he's just a crazy old guy who thinks he was Elvis, because all of the other people at the old folks' home seem to think they're also famous people. His friend in the movie is John F. Kennedy, but he's a black man, and so Elvis is like, you know, JFK was a white man, right? And he's like, nah, see, they tattooed me black so that I wouldn't know that I was JFK. So probably this character is not actually Elvis, but there's nothing in the movie to say one way or the other. So he's living in this old folks home and people keep dying at the old folks home in like weird, violent ways, not in the ways you typically die at an old folks home. And there's weird stuff. There's like a beetle running around that's trying to like kill Elvis. And it turns out this is all linked to the spirit of a mummy who was being transported on a bus and the bus crashed in a nearby river. So now it's up to a very elderly Elvis and black John F. Kennedy to fight this evil mummy. I really, really liked this movie. I knew I was going to. This is one of those movies I just kind of knew, like, I'm probably gonna like that a lot. And I was right, I did enjoy this a lot. It's very funny. It's very funny. Maybe the funniest thing Don Coscarelli's done? I don't know, I enjoy John Dies at the end, but, I don't know, I got a lot of laughs out of this one. There's a there's a scene where Elvis, like, it's just a recurring thing in this movie that he has a growth on his penis, and they have to, like, rub ointment on it, and at one point the nurse is rubbing ointment on his dick, and he gets an erection, and he's like, it's been 2 presidential elections since I had an erection, and it's the funniest fucking scene, the way they play it out. I'm just like, holy shit, I was losing it, I was dying laughing. This is also the Elvis impersonator that Elvis decides to switch places with was working in Nacogdoches, Texas, which is where I went to college. I'm a graduate of Stephen F. Austin State University, based out of Nacogdoches, Texas. You never hear Nacogdoches talked about in movies. Maybe it gets mentioned in Bernie, the Richard Linklater movie Bernie, because that does take place out in East Texas and does have a lot of places that I have been to in it, but... I don't know if that one specifically references Nacogdoches. This might be the only movie I've ever seen that references Nacogdoches. It was also clearly not filmed in Nacogdoches. I could tell. I'm like, that's not Nacogdoches. And I looked, and yeah, this whole film was shot in California, but he does go to Nacogdoches, even if it's not really Nacogdoches. Because, like, who would know the difference? Like, how many people are gonna realize that this isn't Nacogdoches? Me and no one else. I am the only person who has ever lived in Nacogdoches who cares about this movie. That's probably not true, but... I sound off to all my Nacogdoches followers, if there are any. I assume... Sometimes my friend Brett will comment on videos. I don't know how often he watches videos, but he did text me and tell me he enjoyed my performance as Bob Ross recently. So shout out to Brett. If I go back to Nacogdoches, I probably will pretty soon, actually. Sometime like late November, early December, I'll go back to Nacogdoches. I'm gonna have to bring this and show it to him. But yeah, this is one of those movies that I just kind of... I held off on watching for a while because I knew I was gonna enjoy it. And for some reason, knowing that I'm gonna enjoy a movie makes me more apprehensive to watch it, because I'm worried I'm gonna get caught in like a dry spell of like, oh my god, none of these movies are good. Well, at least I have this ace up my sleeve. I know this one is one I'm gonna enjoy. That's why I haven't watched... I have copies of Spider Baby and Requiescent, and I'm like, these are definitely movies I'm gonna enjoy. I can just tell I'm gonna enjoy these movies, but I'm gonna hold off on watching them because I want to save them for, like, the perfect moment. The perfect moment. And I think this was the perfect moment for Bubba Ho-Tep, because I needed something to go along with Army of Darkness, and I'm like, oh, Bubba Ho-Tep, obviously. And then I needed a third movie, and I'm like, well, this is Don Coscarelli, so we could jump back into the Phantasm franchise. I did also think about showing Sundown Vampire in Retreat. Let me grab that. There it is. Sundown Vampire in Retreat, starring Bruce Campbell. Could have made it a whole Bruce Campbell triple feature, but I've decided to hold off on this one. Because, I don't know, I wanted to jump back into the Phantasm franchise a little faster. I don't know how long it's going to take to watch. I might not even do the 4th and 5th movies. I am at least going to do Phantasm 3, but maybe not the 4th or 5th one. Apparently, they were planning on having Bruce Campbell appear in the final Phantasm movie, but they never got the final Phantasm movie made. And they probably aren't now, because Angus Scrimm is dead, unless they filmed a lot of footage of him before he died, which is a complete possibility when it comes to Don Coscarelli and the Phantasm series. They might have shot all of all of Angus Scrimm's stuff for Phantasm's End well before they're ever gonna finish Phantasm's End. So... fingers crossed, maybe we'll get Phantasm's End starring Bruce Campbell, but probably not. at the very least, I am glad Bruce Campbell and Don Coscarelli got to work on a project together. And I'm glad it was as good as this one, because this one's really good. It's based on a short story, and from what I understand, the author of the short story has written other stories about Elvis. And this movie ends with an advertisement for Bubba Nosferatu, a sequel to Bubba Ho-Tep that never got made, unfortunately. I mean, there's still time. They could still make it. Don Coscarelli's still around. Bruce Campbell's still around. Bruce Campbell would probably be more age-appropriate for it now, because he has to play young Elvis in this, too, and he works for young Elvis. And not to say he doesn't work as old Elvis. He does. The makeup in this movie is really good. Bruce Campbell looks shockingly like my own grandfather, who lives in East Texas. He lives right outside Nacogdoches, so what the fuck? You guys think my grandfather's Elvis? I sure hope not. I don't really like my grandfather that much. Don Coscarelli, I am still perfectly willing to watch Bubba Nosferatu if you can get that out. But my point was, obviously the sequel never came out, but there are, like, canon comic books that follow up the story of Bubba Ho-Tep. So, not a complete watch. There is more Bubba Ho-Tep content out there if you want it. Oh yeah, there's no Elvis music in this movie about Elvis, because according to Don Coscarelli, getting the rights to an Elvis song would have cost half the budget. So there's just no Elvis music in this movie. That is probably the one thing I think would improve this movie just a little bit, is if they could get some Elvis music in there. Because it's a little awkward that there is none. I don't know. Overall, Bubba Ho-Tep, it's a wonderful movie. I think this movie probably didn't do super great upon release, because this came out in 2002. And this really does not feel like a movie from the 2000s. This feels like something that should have come out in, like, the 90s, if not the 80s. So, but by 2002, the audience for, like, this type of weird genre film had kind of dried up, right? Like, this would have played, like, drive-ins and grindhouses back in the day, and then, you know, had a bunch of showings, like midnight showings on cable TV. If it had come out in, like, the 80s or 90s, by the 2000s, like, none of that shit was happening anymore, so it's like, Bubba Ho-Tep, it kind of flopped when it came out. Then again, the budget was so fucking low, they did actually make money, I think. I think they did make some money back on this, because it cost, like, nothing to make. But, you know, it didn't do super well. It was not super popular. It has found its audience, and rightfully so. It's a very funny movie. It's so weird to me that this came out in 2002, because I never would have guessed this came out in 2002. I would have guessed it was much older than that. That's probably the biggest compliment I can give it. It doesn't feel like a movie from 2002. The 2000s were a horrible era for film, especially horror film. Finally, we watched Phantasm 2, the second movie in the Phantasm series. This is, of course, still the set that comes with the orb. I don't have the blades hooked up to it. The blades go right there. But this is from the Spear Collection, I believe is what it's called. The Phantasm Sphere Collection, according to the box. So Phantasm 2 picks up right where the first movie ends, with Mike waking up from this dream and realizing that the tall man is real, and his house gets attacked by the Badinkadinks, the little dwarves that the tall man is using to do his bidding. I call them the Badinkadinks because they look like the Badinkadinks from Spaceballs. So Reggie has to blow up the house to destroy all of them. But then we cut to Mike in a mental institution where they have convinced him that the tall man never existed, nor did the events of Phantasm, and he's just now being released, and because he's convinced them that he no longer believes in the Phantasm stuff, and then immediately after he's released, he goes to the graveyard and starts digging up graves. And Reggie finds him there, and Reggie's disappointed in him, but then he opens the casket, and there's no body in the casket, and Reggie's like, what? What's going on? And then they're going to Reggie's house, and, like, his wife and daughter and, like, some other family members from out of town are there, and the tall man blows up the house before we see any of those people, because Reggie never had a wife and child. They didn't even bother casting Reggie's wife and child in this movie. The house blows up before we ever get to see them. So now they're chasing down the tall man, kind of to get revenge, I guess. Also, Mike keeps seeing this girl in his dreams, and she keeps seeing him in her dreams, so they're trying to, like, meet up somewhere. And he does eventually find her and rescue her from the tall man. Just a wild, crazy adventure. Much like the first Phantasm. I do kind of see why the first Phantasm gets a little more respect. This is not quite as good as the first Phantasm. It's not quite as smart as the first Phantasm. Honestly, the second one, I prefer the third one. I think the third one is better than the second one, even. So, this is by no means the best movie of the series, but it is a very fun installment. I do really enjoy this one. It also has some, like, really weird stuff in it. Like, that just kind of works. It has, like, weird dream logic, like the first movie. And it doesn't end on the reveal that it was all a dream. Or was it? This is like, no, this is all real. This is all canon. This is also the movie that they decided Reggie, the ice cream man, is gonna be a fucking badass. He builds a quadruple barrel shotgun, which is the coolest shit. I don't know about the practicality of that. I don't know if you actually could make a quadruple barrel shotgun. I think it'd be very difficult. Adam Savage of Mythbusters, I need you to get on that one. But the quadruple barrel shotgun, so fucking rad. I guess I don't have as much to say about this one. I did say a little about it while I was talking about Bubba Ho-Tep, but I mean, it's a good movie. It's a really interesting movie. well, probably one thing worth noting, in this movie, Reggie is driving a Hemi Cuda, and I think it's different from the one in the first movie. They have a very specific model of Hemi Cuda that was made in, like, limited supply, and then they fucking wreck it. They're just like, oh, this extremely rare muscle car? Yep, we're gonna destroy it. Fuck you. Ah, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing to see. It's just a really fun, enjoyable follow-up to the first Phantasm movie. If you like the first Phantasm movie, I would definitely recommend checking out the second and third ones, if not the whole series. I don't hate the fourth and fifth movies. The fourth one is the worst. The fourth one is decidedly the worst, and the fifth one has some weird eccentricities about it. Probably because it was a collection of, it was supposed to be, like, a short film about Phantasm, or at least seemingly multiple short films about Phantasm set in the Phantasm universe. And at some point, they had filmed so much for these short films, they're like, ah, fuck it, let's just make it a movie. So they filmed, they made it over, like, 8 years, And it was clearly not supposed to be the final installment, even though it probably will be the final installment. But that makes it a little awkward in context, but it's still fun. It's still enjoyable. I like it. It has really good moments, which I think I can say about all of the movies. If Phantasm 2. If you like Phantasm, watch Phantasm 2. Watch the whole Phantasm franchise. We'll definitely be talking about Phantasm 3 eventually. We'll see about 4 and 5. Sound off in the comments if you would like to hear me talk about 4 and 5. Let me know. I'll take audience interest into account for those two. You want to hear me talk about Phantasm 4 and 5? Let me know. We'll see about it. Obviously I have all 5 of them. Last time I asked you what sort of, like, cult indie movie actor do you think should have broken through to the mainstream? Obviously that was a setup for showing some movies with Bruce Campbell in it, because Bruce Campbell's an amazing actor. I could also possibly say Pam Grier, although she did get a bit of a critical reevaluation in the 90s. She had Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. People forget she was in that. But then there was, like, Jackie Brown and, Mars Attacks that featured her. So she got her appreciation when the time came, but I would have liked to see more of her in mainstream movies. Especially way back in the day. Like, she should have been in more stuff in, like, the 70s and 80s. And I mean, there's a lot of actors I could mention for that, and you guys have mentioned some of them, so let's move it to your comments. Lino said Dick Miller, which is a really good answer. I really like Dick Miller. In a lot of Roger Corman films. Also, like, Joe Dante loves him. To the point when I was watching Twilight Zone the movie, I could tell which segment was Joe Dante's because Dick Miller showed up. They walk into the diner and Dick Miller's at the counter, and I'm like, oh, this is Joe Dante's segment. I can already tell. He cast Dick Miller. That's Joe Dante's segment. His character was named Walter Paisley in, like, half the movies he was in. That was his character from A Bucket of Blood. Great movie, by the way. I don't know if I'll show it on the show, actually. It's public domain. I'd rather just do, like, a live stream of Bucket of Blood, because it's public domain. I can just show it. I can just show it to you guys. I love Bucket of Blood. Dick Miller, just an amazing actor. Really enjoy seeing him in things. To be fair, he was in with the right people, you know? He was in with Corman, he was in with Joe Dante, and they just, like, make good movies, so... John August said Dennis Lawson, who played Wedge in Star Wars. He was also in the film Local Hero, which is kind of a weird indie British film. I was not super into it, but I know a lot of people like it. I think he's a decent actor. I can't say I've seen a whole lot of him, but... Maybe he'd have been a good actor. I just googled him for, like, some sort of reference. He's Ewan McGregor's uncle, and I like Ewan McGregor, so... Dennis Lawson, decent answer. That's sort of an odd case where, like, he's in Star Wars, which is, like, this huge franchise, but he's such a minor character that it's, like... Yeah, man, who cares? I suppose I could also add here Terrence Stamp. Terrence Stamp plays a minor role in Star Wars. Although, Terrence Stamp was Zod, so maybe that doesn't count. He was Zod in Superman 2. So, Is Terrence Stamp an indie cult actor? Because other than that, it was mostly like niche stuff that most people haven't heard of. Although, he's in Last Night in Soho, which... good movie. I really enjoyed Last Night in Soho. And I'm really glad Terrence Stamp is in it. I love seeing Terrence Stamp in things. John Cleveland just decided to name all of them, so... Lance Henriksen. Yeah, okay, great actor. Although, he was an Alien, and a pretty major role in Alien 2, so... I would maybe dispute his indie status. Good actor, though. I want to say he was the one James Cameron wanted to play the Terminator before he met Schwarzenegger. I know he wanted some scrawny guy to play the Terminator, and I'm pretty sure it was Lance Henriksen. Bruce Campbell, we already talked about at length. Michael Ironside, yeah, okay. Okay, I'll consider him an indie cult actor. He's definitely on the bigger end, but I suppose so is Bruce Campbell. Like, most people know who Bruce Campbell is. People know who Michael Ironside is. He's not super popular or anything. He's a good actor, though. I really like Michael Ironside. I love Prom Night 2, Hello Mary Lou, that he's in. Pam Grier, already talked about. Warren Oates, who is in some Sam Peckinpah movies. He's the star of Bring Me the Head of Alfredo Garcia, which is... oh, beautiful movie. Maybe Peckinpah's best? I really like that movie, and he's the star of that. So yeah, I'll agree with that one too. He's Luke Goss, who's more of a recent actor. He's in Hellboy 2 and Blade 2, so apparently he's in with Del Toro. So that makes me trust him. I like Blade 2. I think Blade 2 is kind of underrated. Michael Moriarty, who's in a lot of... shit, fuck, I'm blanking on the director's name. Good director. Directed The Stuff. Michael Moriarty was in The Stuff, so... Larry Cohen. Fuck, thank you. Larry Cohen. He's in a couple Larry Cohen movies. I'll accept this answer. I don't actually know who you're referring to specifically, but I'll accept that answer. Bill Mollison and Sid Haig. Obviously a Rob Zombie fan we got here. But I agree, both of them really good actors. Bill Mollison has such a good voice. I wish he had done more acting. Because outside of, like, the Rob Zombie trilogy, the thing he's most known for is, like, Texas Chainsaw 2, which he does a really good job in it. I don't like Texas Chainsaw 2 that much, but I like Bill Mollison in it. Hold on. Bill Mollison? It's so fucking... Mosselli. I'm gonna go with Mosselli. Bill Mosselli. Bill Mollison. Bill Mosselli. The S is before the L, but I keep wanting to put the L before the S. Bill Mosselli. And Sid Haig. Sid Haig. Brilliant actor. Love him. Carolyn Monroe, who was a Bond girl. She was a Bond girl, but... but yeah, she's in a lot of fun stuff. Star Crash, The Golden Voyage of Sinbad, Dracula AD 1972. So, yeah, okay, I'll live with that choice. I don't know that she's a particularly great actress, but she's in some fun movies. He also puts some honorable mentions for Nathan Fillion, Rutger Hauer, Brad Dourif, and Robert Englund, who he says are arguably all big stars. Brad Dourif deserved better. I love Brad Dourif. I think he is one of the best actors. made like top 100 actors of all time, Brad Dourif. Like, everything he's in, he's just the best part of. Especially, like, some of, like, the really shitty stuff he's in. He's in a Cynthia Rothrock movie. I forget which one. It has, like, the most generic fucking name. But he is the best part of that movie, far and away. Nathan Fillion, Rutger Hauer, Robert Englund, all also great actors, love all of them. Nathan Fillion should be in more stuff, but I do think I see just enough of him. He does get a decent amount of attention. He deserves a little more, but he does get a decent amount of attention. John Cleveland also chimed in to let me know that Richard Stanley beat his wife, probably past tense on that one. So that's unfortunate. Didn't know about that, but probably worth mentioning since I was talking positively about him last episode. I didn't know. I'm sorry. Anyways, this week's question is, what's your biggest regret? Movie-wise, I mean. What movie do you regret watching the most? Because last year we did a triple feature of Thanksgiving slasher movies, and I definitely regret watching Thanksgiving 3. But this year we've got two more Thanksgiving-themed slasher movies, and then one movie that I just have to show alongside one of them. So we're starting with the one that is not a Thanksgiving movie, The Burning, classic slasher from the 80s. Following that, we've got Home Sweet Home, mostly forgotten slasher movie from the mid-80s. And then finally, we've got Madman, which I am showing alongside The Burning for a very specific reason, but we'll talk about that next time. Until then, I'm Matt. Happy Thanksgiving, I guess. This is probably going up the day after Thanksgiving, but happy Thanksgiving.